Hello and good morning, friends. Today I want to talk to you about well pits. What are they? When will you find them? And are they really that bad? You always hear about people wanting to extend it up above the surface. So let's go ahead, take a look at one, and let's talk about it. So well pits are going to be an older style of where you basically keep your well and your well equipment. You'll usually, at least in our state, you'll only really see that on homes before 1965. Maybe 1970, depending on where you're at. Basically, all that a well pit is just a little container area. Usually, it's just going to be made of cinder blocks. Sometimes it's concrete, but it's like a little outbuilding. And that's where you keep the well, the pump, the pressure tank. If it's large enough, sometimes you'll even put the equipment. Now, you might be wondering, well, why a well pit? And the answer is really simple. A lot of it, at least in our area, comes from the way that the spring houses were made. So before we were drilling wells, most people were getting their water from aquifer, like basically water sources such as streams, creeks, springs, those sorts of things. They were all kind of groundwater sources. By groundwater sources, I don't mean necessarily the same thing like what we would see for a drilled well, but I mean stuff that's like on the actual surface of the ground, and that's where the water would come in. So a spring house basically would be a little concrete structure, usually a couple of feet in total height, maybe a foot and a half, 2 feet wide, and it would just be a little basin in there. And as the water on the ground would go through, the basin would collect water, and then they would put a foot valve to connect to their pump, which will then pump the water into the house. Now, the spring houses were basically what everybody did, and everybody learned that springs and creeks and rivers and streams aren't really the best of water sources because there's usually a lot of contaminants. These contaminants usually would basically make people sick, right? And there were also times where it was not as reliable. Let's just say you had a small spring-fed system where we went through a drought. If we went through a 2 or 3 month drought, guess what? You don't have any water. So that's where we started to drill our wells. We got cleaner water, more reliable, less seasonal influence. So when you're drilling the well, you're basically just putting a hole in the ground. But because everybody was doing the same thing with spring houses, again, at least in our area, they would just build the same process for a spring house just around a well. And now it needed to be a little bit bigger because now you needed to put the pump in there and the pressure tank. So whenever you have these well pits, basically you would just put a wooden cover. Sometimes it'd be cinder block, sometimes it'd be concrete covers. It just kind of depends on what you had available. So let's go look at one real quick and I'll kind of talk you through what's going on. So what we have here is a well pit, right? So we have our lid, which is just going to be 2x4s with some metal sheeting on top. We're going to have our styrofoam that's going to act as our insulation. We have our electrical wires. This one's full of dirt, so you can't really see the well, but right where that yellow wire is, that's where the well pumps, or the well itself's going to be. The pump's going to be the bottom of that. This particular system's going to be a submersible. Now, well pits, why I don't like them. You see how all of this styrofoam is chewed up and torn up? That means that a field mouse or some kind of rodent or some kind of creature has actively gotten into this pit and is basically making it into their home. With all of that soil sitting on top of the well, there is a lid that does have seals, but once the soil is getting in, that means groundwater is also getting in on top. So if those seals have failed, now you've got additional debris, additional sediment, additional potential contaminants getting into your water, especially that real fine particulates of the styrofoam. So with a modern well, the well head's actually going to extend above the surface. And the reason why is so that way any groundwater from the surface cannot get up and into the well. Same thing with any kind of vermin, like roaches, ants, bees, stuff like that. We don't want any of that stuff getting into the well, potentially building a nest, dying, falling in, pooping, peeing, all that good stuff in your drinking water. So modern standards are going to bring all of those wells up. Now, if you have an older home, the odds of you having to like having a well and a well pit are pretty high. So we usually will recommend that if you have a well pit that you want to bring it up. But if you don't, is it the end of the world? No. But you do run a higher risk of contaminants and stuff getting in there. Now, with a well and a well pit, generally you're going to have a shallower well, meaning that well is more influenced by seasonal change. At least in our area, most of the shallow wells aren't as productive, and they're usually lower yielding, meaning you have to be more mindful of how much water you're using. Otherwise, you run the risk of that pump running dry. And if the pump runs dry, the pump burns up. Pumps are not cheap, so we don't want to do any of that. If you do have a low yielding well, there are ways to mitigate your risk, such as putting a low pressure cutoff or a pump saver. Easy enough to install. It will save you money, but something to think about. Well pits generally are fairly shallow. Every now and again, you'll get one that's going to be pretty deep. I had a well pit about maybe 2 weeks ago where it was a solid 10 feet to get into that pit. Now, at that point, that's confined space entry, so you got to be very, very careful whenever it comes to working and dealing with those systems. It also is really annoying to work on them because pressure tanks are heavy. So if you have a waterlogged tank or repair, you got to go far down to get it out. Further down the well pit is, the more difficult the repair is, because getting pressure tanks in and out of that hole really sucks. You can't really do it by yourself. It's a two-man job. You're usually gonna have to use some kind of winch or some kind of pulley to get it up and get it out, especially if the tank's a big one, right? Like some of these tanks, they're pretty heavy just on their own. The smaller ones, not as much, but they still got some weight to them. And you know, lowering that 10, 15 feet down or getting it up out of a hole 10 or 15 feet down kind of sucks. So if you have a well pit, like I said, strongly recommend get it extended to grade. We've talked about a few things to pay attention to, such as lower yielding wells, but it's very important to make sure if you have a well in a well pit that you are testing regularly for your water quality. The EPA recommends to test at least once a year. I always, always advise, take that recommendation, right? Doesn't cost that much, especially if you go to a lab, or if you have somebody come to your house, it'll be a little bit more expensive to do it that way, but it's worth every penny to know what you're drinking. Now, if you have any questions or comments, leave them below, right? I try to get to all of them as best I can. I wanted to make a quick video on this because I don't see them super, super often, but I do come across them from time to time, and I figured some of you out there might actually have one too. If you got any value out of this or you found this entertaining, hit that like button, hit subscribe. I have more videos posted every day on the world of well and septic. I hope that I get to see you tomorrow, and I look forward to seeing you soon.